Good evening. So in the fetal urogenital system part 1, we will include renal anomalies, while in part 2, we will include the bladder, adrenal and the other anomalies. So traditionally, the screening for the congenital anomalies of the kidney and the urinary tract, called as CACUT, is done at our routine anomaly scan between 19 to 21 weeks. We should remember that these anomalies are the evolving anomalies and that in the later gestation, the detection rate is quite higher. That means in the second and the third trimester, the anomalies are quite evident. But with the inversion of the pyramid of the fetal care, we need to evaluate the GUT in the first trimester also, though we must remember that the detection rate of the CACUT is lowest in the first trimester. The ISUG guidelines say that in the first trimester, the evaluation of the bladder and the kidneys is optional, while second trimester onwards, we should see for the kidneys as well as the bladder. The kidneys are evaluated in the axial, parasitoidal plane and the coronal plane. In the axial view, we take the renal pelvic diameter. In the parasitoidal view, the renal length is measured, the kidney length is measured from the upper to the lower pole, and then there are different nomograms available regarding the length and the weeks of gestation. And in the coronal view, basically we evaluate the renal arteries. And there is a ratio between the renal circumference to the abdominal circumference, which is 0.27 to 0.03, which is constant throughout the pregnancy. Now, how do the kidney look on ultrasound? In the first trimester, with the high resolution TA or the TVS, the kidneys are seen as rounded structures, which are bright. There is an anechoic center, which is nothing but the renal pelvis. And the optimal visualization in the first trimester is basically in the coronal plane. Well, in the second and the third trimester, we see the typical oval shape of the kidneys, and the echogenicity of the kidneys then decreases and is less than the liver and that of the spleen. The corticomedullary differentiation is seen better in the late second trimester and the third trimester. And how do we identify the cortex and the medulla? That the outer hyperechoic is the renal cortex, while the hypoechoic center is the renal medulla. The urinary bladder is seen from the 10th week onwards. It is seen as a rounded anechoic structure with echogenic walls, and in the first trimester, the longitudinal length of the bladder should be less than 7 mm, then the wall thickness should be less than 2 mm. Bladder is identified by the perivesical arteries on the color Doppler. When we begin our ultrasound scan in the first trimester, first thing we should do is to assess the bladder, because if we don't see the bladder, we get at least some time to assess the bladder. Without visualizing the bladder in the first trimester, the NT scan is not complete. The ureters and the urethra is not visible prenatally unless they are deceased. Sonographically, the CACUT may present as urinary tract dilatation, pathologies of the location and number, altered renal echogenicity, bladder pathology, and all of this affecting the amniotic fluid. So how will we proceed when we see a case of hydronephrosis? So we should follow this algorithm. When we see hydronephrosis, first see if the ureters are dilated or not. If the ureters are not dilated, then it is probably a PUG obstruction. If the ureters are dilated, look for the bladder. How is the bladder? If the bladder is not dilated, if the bladder is normal, it could be PU obstruction or it can be unilateral UV reflux. And if the bladder is dilated, see the severity of the bladder. If the bladder is severely dilated, then it can be posterior urethral wall or urethral atresia. While if the bladder is moderately dilated, it can be bilateral UV reflux. Grading of hydronephrosis. Why should we grade the hydronephrosis? We should grade it because it is an important prognostic sonographic finding. Accordingly, we can plan antenatal follow-up to see if the pathology is worsening or regressing. And then it also helps us for the proper counseling of the parents. Also, grading is important for planning antenatal and the postnatal therapies. Hydronephrosis used to be graded subjectively into mild, moderate and severe, but subjective evaluation is always confusing. Hence, anteroposterior renal pelvic diameter measurement is used to grade the hydronephrosis. The RPD is measured in the transverse or the axial section, where the spine can be at 12 o'clock or 6 o'clock position, and the anteroposterior diameter of the intrarenal part of the pelvis is measured. And the RPD of more than or equal to 4 mm before 32 weeks and more than or equal to 7 mm from 32 weeks onwards is considered as pathological. And when the RPD is between 4 to 10 millimeters, it is mild hydronephrosis, 10.1 to 15 is moderate hydronephrosis, and more than 15 is severe hydronephrosis. But the grading of hydronephrosis depending on RPD doesn't tell anything about the renal parenchyma or the calyceal dilatation. So for that, the Society of Fetal Urology proposed a grading system where, along with the dilation of the renal pelvis, calyceal dilation and parenchymal thinning were also included. So there are 5 grades from 0 to 4 depending on the splitting of the pelvis, dilation of the calyces and then the parenchymal thinning. And then there is one more Onen's classification, which is quite similar to the SFU grading system. There are high chances of subjective error, and in these classification systems, a lot of confusion is created, and therefore there is variability in the post-settlement management. So in 2014, there came consensus on the classification of the prenatal and the postnatal urinary tract dilatation called the UTD classification system. The UTD affects nearly 1-5% of all pregnancies, and a lot of confusing terminologies like hydronephrosis, pyelectasis, pelvic atelectasis and etc. are used. So the consensus opinion is that instead of using confusing terminologies, a common terminology is proposed, and that is the urinary tract dilation. According to this classification, the fetuses are divided into the low and the high risk group. An important thing is that the UTD classification system is endorsed by the Society of Maternal Fetal Medicine, the AIUM, ACR and also the SFU. So what are the ultrasound parameters used in this UTD classification system? The anterior-posterior renal pelvic diameter is one of the important factors. Also, we evaluate the central and the peripheral calyceal dilatation. Then the parenchymal thickness is evaluated, which is a subjective assessment. Then the parenchymal appearance we need to evaluate, where we see the echogenicity, the corticomedullary differentiation and the presence or absence of any cortical cyst. Then ureters are also evaluated, and we see for the dilatation of the ureter. If the transiently dilated ureters are visualized, then they are considered to be normal. Then we evaluate here the bladder, where we evaluate the bladder wall thickness, the presence or absence of ureterocele, and we see even for the posterior urethral valve. The RPD cutoffs used are the same. That means that if it is less than 4 millimeters, it is normal. The RPD cutoffs are the same. That means 4 and 7 millimeters. But the weeks of the gestations are changed here. That means between 16 to up to 28 weeks, if the RPD, if it is less than 4 millimeters, then it is normal. And it should be less than 7 millimeters after 28 weeks to call it as normal. And then the calyceal dilatation, the parenchymal thickness, all these appearances should be normal. So according to the UTD classification system, there are two groups, UTD A1, which is a low risk group, and UTD A2 and 3, which are the high risk group. So when the RPD is between 4 to 6.9 millimeters between 16 to 27 weeks, and when it is between 7 to 9.9 millimeters after 28 weeks with central or no calyceal dilatation, then it is UTD A1 or a low risk group. And when the RPD is more than 7 millimeters between 16 to 27 weeks and after 28 weeks, when the RPD is more than 10 millimeters and there is associated any or one of this finding like peripheral calyceal dilatation or abnormal parenchymal thickness or abnormal appearance of the parenchyma or abnormal ureter, any of this when it is present, then it is UTD A2-3, means it is a increased risk group or a high risk group. And the follow-up protocol is also suggested by the UTD classification system, where in the low-risk group, one additional follow-up is required after or at 32 weeks of gestation. And here we can very well reassure the parents that the chances of the disease in progression will be less. And in the high-risk group, we need to follow up every 4 to 6 weeks, and postnatally the ultrasound should be done after 48 hours of the delivery. And we have to have a detailed discussion with the parents regarding the progression of the disease, and whenever required, we need to take the help of the geneticist or the specialist consultation who will do the postnatal management is also important in the high-risk group. There is diverse etiology for the UTD. In majority of the cases, it is transient. Majority of the mild hydronephrosis are transient or physiological, and this could be because of the insufficient maturation of the pelvic or the vesicoureteric junction, or due to ureteric folds, or due to overproduction of the urine. Next common is the pelvic junction obstruction, and then with the decreasing rate of incidence, it is VU reflux, and then the uretrovesical junction obstruction, duplex collecting system, multicystic dysplastic kidney, and the luto. The studies regarding the prognosis of the hydronephrosis were done before the UTD classification system, and they were done depending based on the RPDs. When the RP dilatation is mild, that is less than 7 millimeters, only 10 to 15% progress to the postnatal disease. Whereas when the RP dilatation is severe, that is more than 10 millimeters, then nearly 90% of the patient will require postnatal therapy. The other prognostic factors will include if it's a unilateral or bilateral involvement, parenchymal echogenicity, presence or absence of cortical cyst, oligohydramnios, and associated malformation and markers of aneuploidy. So let's see how to report a case of UTD. So first you have to mention about the renal pelvic diameters. Then you have to see for the calyceal status to see if the major calyces and the minor calyces are dilated. Then look at the parenchymal thickness and the parenchymal echogenicity. Here, the parenchymal thickness is slightly reduced while the parenchymal echogenicity is highly echogenic parenchyma. Look for the ureters. Here in this case, you can see a dilated ureter. Then you have to mention about the bladder. The bladder size here is apparently normal. It is not too much dilated bladder. And then we also need to report about the bladder outlet and the Liker status. And if in any case you see that there is only dilated renal pelvis, other things are normal, then your report should include the RPD diameters. And then you have to write that the renal parenchyma, the calyces, the ureter, bladder, everything is normal. This will be the complete reporting according to the UTD classification system. Now the second set is the abnormalities in the number and the location of the kidneys, which will include unilateral agenesis, bilateral renal agenesis, ectopic kidney and the fusion anomalies. The sonographic finding in the unilateral renal agenesis is that we will see an empty renal fossa. We will see a lying down or a sleeping adrenal sign, which is an elongated adrenal in the renal fossa. Because the other kidney is seen and is normal, the AFI can be normal, but we should also look in this case for the anomalies of the visualized or the present kidney. Because renal agenesis is associated with vectoral anomalies, we need to evaluate the vertebral, the spinal, the cardiac, the GI system very thoroughly. Bilateral renal agenesis is again a lethal condition, and associated cardiac, cerebral and skeletal anomalies and is quite common. On ultrasound, we see early anhidramnios, which is seen from 16 weeks onwards. The bladder is not seen, the renal fossae are empty, there are bilateral sleeping adrenal sign, and on color Doppler we see the absent renal arteries. Embryologically, kidneys are formed in the pelvis and they ascend to the normal position. Failure to ascend leads to the ectopic kidney. Pelvic location is quite common, where we can see the kidneys very close to the bladder. Horseshoe kidney and cross-fused ectopic kidneys are the type of fusion anomalies which can be detected antenatally. Now coming to the echogenic kidneys. When kidneys are more echogenic than liver and spleen after 17 weeks, then they are called as the echogenic kidneys. The common non-hereditary causes are obstructive dysplasia and multicystic kidney disease. The rare causes are like nephroblastomatosis, renal vein thrombosis, ischemia, aneuploidies and the infections. The common hereditary causes include the autosomal recessive and the dominant type of the polycystic kidney disease. And then echogenic kidneys are a part of certain syndromes. Now how to evaluate a case of hyperechoic kidneys? First and foremost, we should see for the volume or the size of the kidney. The kidneys can be small, as in cases of obstructive renal dysplasia, or they can be increased in the volume because of macrocysts or microcysts. Macrocysts are commonly seen with multicystic kidneys. Microcystic pattern is seen with polycystic kidney and can be associated with other anomalies and syndrome. Hyperechoic kidneys with a normal volume is a real troublesome issue because it can be a variant of normal. We must thoroughly scan the fetus before labeling it as a normal variant. In report, we should mention about the normalcy of the bladder and the Liker, and then also we should ask for any family history of the renal disease or any previous child having renal disease. And then we should suggest a follow-up when suspected cases of normal variation of the hyperechoic kidneys. Now the autosomal recessive polycystic kidney disease or the ARPKD, it is caused because of the monogenic mutation in the PKHD1 gene. There is fusiform cystic dilation of the collecting duct. To begin with, the medulla becomes echogenic and then the tubular strands reach up to the cortex, and then the whole of the cortex becomes echogenic and the corticomedullary junction is lost and whole of the kidney looks echogenic. But on ultrasound, we can have normal kidneys up to 20 weeks of gestation. Later the size of the kidney can increase. And it can increase up to plus 1 to plus 5 of the standard deviation. As I told, the kidneys are hyperechoic with loss of CM differentiation. Because the nephrons are now non-functioning, the urine is not produced and the bladder is not visualized. And because urine is not produced, there is severe oligohydramnios, and it is a lethal condition mainly because of the pulmonary hypoplasia caused because of oligohydramnios. While the autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease is characterized by multiple cysts that arise mainly from all the areas of the nephron and very few from the collecting ducts. These are tiny cysts, and as we know that the nephrons are in the cortex, these tiny cysts in the nephron will first cause increase in the cortical echogenicity. And therefore the hyperechoic cortex and the hypoechoic medulla is the commonest sonographic finding in ADPKD. In few cases we can get cortical cysts also. While echogenic medulla with loss of CM differentiation, the typical like of that of ARPKD is very less common, and when it is seen, the differentiation between the ARPKD and the ADPKD becomes very difficult. As this tiny cyst will not compromise the urine production in this early stage, we can see the renal pelvis and the bladder, and therefore the AFact is normal. And now the multicystic kidney dysplasia. For the formation of the nephrons, there should be stimulus from the ureteric bud. If the ureteric bud is not formed, then the metanephric vesicles will convert into multiple cysts of various sizes. And this is nothing but the multicystic kidney dysplasia. It is usually a unilateral condition. In an ultrasound, we get increased volume of the kidney. There are multiple non-communicating cysts of variable sizes, and because of the cyst, the outline is irregular. And because of the cyst also, there is absence in the central sinus structures. There is no parenchyma, only connective tissue is seen. In 25-40% of cases, the contralateral kidney can be also abnormal. And the common abnormality is the reflux, because the origin is basically from the ureteric bud. The pathology originates in the abnormal ureteric bud, and therefore the reflux is quite common in the contralateral kidney. Bilateral MCKD is quite rare, and because in this condition, as urine will not be produced, there will be severe oligohydramnios, so and it will be a lethal condition. Obstructive cystic dysplasia is caused because of a very early and a severe obstruction of the urinary tract. Can be unilateral or bilateral. Bilateral involvement is common with the lower urinary tract obstruction. We may be able to find the cause of obstruction. Usually the cortex is hyperechoic, and at times we can see the pericortical cysts. Renal function is impaired in the obstructive cystic dysplastic kidney. At 13 weeks, you can see a hydronephrotic kidney which is enlarged and having an echogenic cortex. The other kidney is showing just a pelvic alveolar fullness. The affected kidney at 19 weeks is now showing the pericortical cyst, while the other kidney is showing a mildly dilated renal pelvis. And then this is a case of Meckel-Gruber syndrome, where the hyperechoic kidney is associated with occipital encephalocele and polydactyly, which is seen in both upper and the lower extremities. The incidence of renal tumor is extremely rare. Usually they are diagnosed in the third trimester. It's usually a unilateral renal involvement. The kidney is partly or totally replaced by mass, show increased vascularity, and may or may not have the capsule. Wilms tumor have association with Beckwith-Wiedemann and other syndromes, and then we have to look for the features of other syndromes on the ultrasound. The conclusion of part 1 is that GUT evaluation begins from the first trimester. CACUT are evolving anomalies. Description of the renal pelvis, calyces, parenchymal characteristics, ureters and bladder is must in a case of urinary tract dilatation. Ultrasound findings can prognosticate the renal outcome. Follow the algorithms which will help us to reach the diagnosis. Thank you very much.